If you're distributing it, if you're coming before, make sure you grab some of that, so you always try to have something to snack on here. This is a new place, I'd love to have pizza. We've got a couple of really cool opportunities coming up. We have the Co-motion Innovation Chat Series happening next Tuesday at Payne Hall. That's gonna be really good. This theme is exploring inclusive solutions to disruption when it comes to the election and thinking about ways that bring people together more with technology. Vikram is gonna be there, he's the vice president of innovation strategy, so Henry Cox, okay. Yeah, I read this turning all the time, but I don't know what it is. Ken Devon, the CEO of the Ocean, is gonna be there, and Senator Jim Harbaugh. That's Copium. That is an area that turned red for the first time in the past election, so we're gonna be talking about what that means and what happened. And then next Friday, this same event, from Missiles, we'll have Ken Meyer here, who's talking about value. He has over 25 years experience working in startups, he's gonna be the master and mentor over at the Fall School business. You guys are gonna love him. And the entrepreneurial law firm is gonna talk about equity allocation. So if you're working on your tax table, today, we have Mike Robinson talking about business market strategies to entrepreneur. Mike's in the ERIR with Co-motion, and he has deep experience in product development, introduction, distribution channels, M&A, venture funding, IPO, and intellectual property creation and management. Mike's been with two different startup companies from absolutely starting from zero all the way up to IPO, which is just an amazing achievement. And since his experience has included both US and global markets, and he's the B2C businesses, and is that deep and broad. He's going to be a fantastic person to balance your go-to-market strategies on the back you have on the card today. And then after Mike is done, we're going to hear from Mike and Kelsey Christensen from the UW Entrepreneurial Clinic. They'll talk about board governance and advisors. So if you've been wondering about fiduciary issues or identification, or if you're starting further back and you haven't decided to get yourself incorporated in Delaware,
So, as kind of a multi-decade entrepreneur, spent my whole life in startup companies, some of which were very successful, got an IPO. One of them was San Francisco for about 4 million, and others were more. So I kind of fit across the gamut, filling roles from engineering through business development, sales, and CEO roles, and so on, and so on, and so on, in the UK. And so what I'd like to do today actually is not talk at you too much. I'd like to make sure we leave lots of time to address whatever's on your mind at the end of the session, whatever troubles you, whatever you're wondering about, and see if we can make this a working session where you can talk out and feel like we actually made progress on the question. As well as having a little more background. Can I just ask, how many people here are part of a natural startup? So about half of you, and for the others, are you thinking about starting a company? You have a project in mind, you haven't started it yet, or? Okay, of the people who are part of the startup, how many of you, are you guys prepared to lecture B2B and B2C? It's a simple way to divide, companies. How many of you are B2B companies? You've got something you can sell businesses. Okay, and the rest, how many are B2C then? And how many of you are not sure? Okay. And one more question, how many of you are planning to produce a physical product? So most of you have to do that. Okay. And the others, it's software or services, I assume? Okay, thanks. So, we're gonna, I think market plans is actually pretty simple. I use a lot of jargon or fancy terms. Going to market is literally, hey, the tomatoes are ripe, Mabel, hitch up the wagon and we're going to take the market. And so Jeff here puts his tomatoes in the wagon and he goes to market, and at market he puts his tomatoes on the table and he meets people and he sells them tomatoes and they give him money. And while he's there, he may also, you know, buy some potatoes to take home or something else. So it's simply a process of getting your product or service to a customer and getting money back in return for that. Why do you need a go-to-market strategy? Well, it's because there's actually lots and lots and lots of ways to go to market. Some things are still sold by putting the tomatoes in the wagon and going to market. We still have farmers markets, for example, where people produce something and then they can bring it to market and sell it. But most things these days are sold through more complicated channels and value chains, where you might be selling directly to the person who's going to use your stuff, but you quite likely are going to sell to someone who's going to sell to someone who's going to sell to someone. Or your stuff is going to get integrated into something that's a chain or many other combinations. So because there are many routes to market, you need to spend some time thinking about what's the right route. Or what's the right combination of routes, because you may end up using more than one. The other thing about go-to-market strategy is it's critical for any venture funding pitch. If you want somebody to invest in your company, you may have the greatest thingamajig, but if you can't clearly explain who's going to buy it and why, then you can't provide that investor with an understanding of how they're going to get a return on their investment. So it's going to be virtually impossible to get somebody to invest in your business unless you're pretty clear about who your customer is, why they're buying it, and how you're using it. And that's what we're going to expect to use. So it starts with the customer. How many of you feel like you clearly know who your customer is? Okay. How many of you have actually got a paying customer?
A lot. Good.
Excellent. How many of you have got more than one paying customer? Excellent. And for those who've got more than one paying customer, do they fit the same profile? Did you reach them the same way? Did you sort of the process, or is it sort of two different, you know, an apple and an orange? An apple and an orange? That's often the case. So just, it's important to know, in order to craft a go-to-market strategy, you have to know exactly who your customer is, because that's what tells you where you're going to find them, how you're going to reach them, what messages they're going to respond to, and how you're going to actually get a return for all of your effort. And customer is not necessarily just one person. You've probably heard people talk about the buyer versus the user, or like Ken, my buddy Ken, who's talking next to me, as you work with those companies, the one that sold Cisco, talks about a little C and a big C. So there's a little C customer, a big C customer. One of them is the user, one of them is the buyer. Does this sound familiar? Have you guys heard this stuff before? Okay, good. Who thinks they can tell me, in one sentence, tell me what to do, and in the next sentence, tell me who your customer is and why they're going to buy it? Come on, some of you have customers. Nobody? Okay.
And our big C customers is the VR platform, and our little C users are the
actual audience
members that will
use the content. And you raise your hand as having paying customers, right? And so are you getting paid now by the platform
users
or by the audience?
Well, we're moving out towards wanting to get paid by platforms. So far, we've had companies pay us to make content.
Right. Which is, that's very technical. So that's a good example of how your route to market may evolve as you try to scale this. You go out and found some customers, but you realize, well, it's going to be a lot of work to keep selling each other to those. Maybe I can find a partner who already has those relationships and I can sell them now. And then I can do the same thing I do and they can sell themselves. Very interesting. Who else? Go on. I'm going to call on somebody to go again. You're up.
Yeah, we make electrical filters that operate in carbon patterns. In particular, we're targeting that our first customer, we don't have a customer yet, but our first customer is going to be manufacturers of pull batteries who purchase this now and we purchase ours in place.
What's she trying to
build? I don't know, but the
Yeah, I don't think we've done it, but I would, so you had a few years, previous summer.
Oh, cool.
Cool. Okay, so, the key is you have to spend time thinking about the customers, and you may find out as you go along that customer isn't necessarily who you thought. So you may have thought that you're selling this profile, but you find out as you're out there, and the only way to find this out is to be out there, try and sell. Now, actually, these people over here are responding better to what I'm offering, and providing a better alignment with what I'm offering. Okay, so examples of route to market. Again, I don't want to lecture too long, but I just want to sort of set some context for you to think about how you're going to get into it. Obviously, you can go direct, so you can sell directly to a customer. Clem selling his tomatoes at market is a direct sale. You can sell face-to-face, person-to-person. You can sell online, obviously, and most people do. You're selling a physical product. In one way or another, it's the easiest thing to start. But it doesn't necessarily mean that if you really do it, you can put it up online and get people to buy it, right? B2B, as a direct sales organization, is a very common model. So if you're selling to businesses and you have a product or service, something like a software or service, you probably are going to have a sales organization, have salespeople that are out there banging on doors, calling people up, chasing them down through email, and getting them to sign up to purchase your product or service. And then I also add shows in there. Trade shows and conferences are obviously a venue for direct selling, for meeting people who you think are likely to want to buy your product and being able to tell them your story and get them to make a commitment and take that next step.
Sorry, I missed the point here. What is DSO?
Direct sales organization.
Okay.
So that's when you hire salespeople. You have a staff of salespeople who are out there talking to buyers, trying to bring in buyers. Okay, retail, well, we're all familiar with retail. You sell your product into the store and consumers buy it there. And I'm going to come back to some of that stuff. Basically, so distribution, OEM, and licensing are five other examples. When you're talking about direct sales, you really have to be clear about who that customer is and how you're going to reach them. Because if you haven't yet figured out exactly what the target is, you're going to be spending a lot of time and money. Time is precious for a startup, right? You're going to be spending a lot of time talking to a lot of people. So you want to make sure, as you're putting in your direct sales effort, that you are learning as you go through all the right people, how do I optimize the amount of time I spend? How do I optimize my target so that I'm reaching out and getting people who are more likely to want to buy as well? Direct online, like I said, is the easiest thing to start, but don't kid yourself about being able to just put it online and people are going to buy. And in fact, even if you spend a little time traffic on your website, conversion rates typically are very low, and you can very easily spend more than you make. At the end of the day, it's good because it's direct, and so you have a direct relationship with that customer. It's, again, an easy thing to start. But just be clear about the reality of what it takes to actually get you on the other side of the customer. Direct sales organization is, again, typical for a B2B business. If you are selling to If you're selling something sophisticated to businesses, odds are you're going to have to employ salespeople, unless you're going to a partner. And then the businesses are a great place to actually just go try to meet people, especially if you're just starting out. Just go. You don't have to have a booth. You don't have to have a booth. You just go and network with people there and see who you can find to respond positively to what you're offering. So retail is a whole interesting one. Is anybody here thinking of going through retail? They may have a consumer product or... Okay, so we'll look at this then. So basically, the thing to understand about retailers is they don't sell anything. They don't have a salespeople, so they just put it on the shelf. And people are going to get it. It's up to you to make people come in and get it. And in fact, if you don't do the job of making people come in and get it, they're going to get you out of the store. So you can put a lot of work, some people think, oh, I've got this great thing, and that's how you get to Target or Walmart or something. You can put a lot of work into that relationship and get the product on the shelf. That's not actually success. Success is when the stuff flies off the shelf and it's ordered, and now you've got a chance to get it. embrace certain things. Think about it, right? There's resell, resell, permanent, or business phone systems. There's a whole industry of people who sell business communication products. And so if you are selling to a particular type of business, see if you can identify who's out there that's selling something similar to what you are offering, or something adjacent to what you're offering. Who's out there that's selling to the same customers? And what you might be able to do is get them to become your channel. So if you go out and you sign those people up to be resellers, and they already have these relationships, they're already calling on these customers, they're already selling something you know, that's close to what you're offering, and your role is going to be get them to carry what you're offering as well, and get them to get attention to them and care about it, which is super critical. They're not going to care about it unless you do. They're just going to be willing to add it to the bag and go out and sell it if they think they can make money from it. And it's going to cost you 30-50% of the total revenue, but it means that you don't have to have this sales force going out and doing this stuff. So it's kind of fair. And the more that your product is easy to sell or is attached or becomes more, you know, mainstream, then the lower percentage that they'll take because it's easier for them to sell whatever they want. And it's just for them all the And then don't underestimate effort doing that. Just because you sign up for reseller doesn't mean you're going to be successful. It takes a lot of time. You have to chase them, you have to follow up, you have to train them, you have to support them. And you're probably going to have to help support the customers as well, even though the reseller has a primary relationship. Okay, OEM is an interesting model. Who's heard of OEM deals before? So I think the term originates in the auto industry. It's original equipment manufacturer deal. And original equipment is like Ferrari, they don't make tires. They don't make windshield wipers. They don't make spark plugs. But every Ferrari ships with tires and windshield wipers and spark plugs. So there is an original equipment manufacturer that makes the original equipment that ships the car. The beauty of that is that you are supplying this other partner and they're taking your stuff and bundling it with something that they sell. And so you don't have to go out and deliver the sales to the customer. You focus your relationship with your partners, bundling your stuff in. The key to success there, again, is getting mindshare attention from the OEM sales staff and getting a high attach rate. So, you know, you get an OEM deal and you're going to sell your stuff with 100,000 units, you're not going to get a lot of return on that. So you want to find the right OEM or your infrastructure or whatever that they're going to sell one or more of your things with every one of their things you sell or most of your things. And then, of course, there's licensing. And so in licensing, the beauty of it is you don't have to make the thing. You just give them the right to make the thing. Okay? So it's also sometimes called white label agreement, where you actually OEM. This is where you find someone who makes and sells something that is similar to what you do or something that can incorporate what you do. And unlike an OEM deal, you don't actually produce the thing at all. So you don't have to manage the factory, you don't have to carry the inventory, you don't have to deal with distribution. You just teach this other company how to make what you know how to make. And the key, of course, is that they pay you for it. They pay you a license for it. So you have to have some kind of know-how that is valuable and expected in order to get them paid. Otherwise, you just sort of hand them the bill. Again, the big advantage here is it's simple. You know, you just, here, I teach you how to do it, and then you send me money. Sounds simple. Actually, you're going to have to be involved in the plan to keep the whole thing going. The disadvantage for licensing deals is that it's overall lower revenue. And you end up having less control. So at each of these stages, from direct sale through reseller through, or retail through reseller through OEM through licensing, your level of control diminishes, but the amount of work that you put into the customer facing part of selling and supporting also diminishes. And so what that means is you get just sort of a different mix of how much of the revenue you get versus how much of the work you have to do yourself. So these are sort of sort of five categories of, you know, different ways to go to market. And you should be thinking about all of these as you think about what threat are you going to take my new product or service or idea out to the world and by the customers. And you should be aware that you're probably going to use more than one. And in particular, you're probably going to start off, hopefully, you're going to start off with some direct sales. Because when you have that direct customer interaction, you get very valuable feedback. And so you learn a lot more from the customers when you're interacting with them directly. But over time, you know, it's hard to scale a sales organization. It's hard to build a brand. It's hard to get, you know, attention and credibility. So you may find that really where you're going to find success is by partnering with someone who already has reach, already has built an organization, already has a brand, already has a trust. And so that's where you sort of move up this chain. As I mentioned, the amount of money that you get out of the deal varies widely depending on what kind of deal you make. So this would be kind of a typical margin stack. Guess what the margin is? That's how much you get left at the end of the day. This is a typical margin stack for either a retail or distribution deal. So a customer spends $100 on your product or service. The channel, the distributors, the retailers, they keep 50. So you only get paid $50. Well, I only got to pay $50 for this stuff for $100, but you didn't have to go sell it. So they put in all the money to go out and promote this and sell it. Let's say your production cost is 25, and so COGS, we have COGS, this cost gets sold, okay? And so then you're still going to have to pay some kind of sales team. Even though you sell your distribution, you have to have channel managers or partner managers or some kind of account manager. And then you get paid, and let's say they get paid, 10 out of your 50. So you're in a contribution margin that ends up being $15 out of that $100 purchase. If you sold it direct, you might also still only have a contribution margin of $15, but you might have a much higher cost of sales that you're out of your marketing spend or whatever on. Or you might have a higher contribution margin, but you might have lower volume. So one of the reasons why you partner with people is not only do they make 15 out of the 100, but they can go sell a boatload of it, and I can only sell a truck of it. Your first few sales, some of you said you have some sales, 1, 2, 3, 4 sales. You probably made those direct, right? Those were people in your network, people that you found somehow. Your first few sales are going to be direct. They should be, ideally. Sometimes that's not possible. Sometimes you have some piece of technology that only makes sense when it's integrated in with some larger thing. And so your sale is always going to be, your payer is always going to be someone that integrates your stuff and then they go sell it to investors. But in many cases, if you've got something that's like a finished product, then you can make those sales directly. And having done that, having learned who the customer is and how to talk to them and how to present the product so it succeeds, you then go find partners who have scale and can ramp it up for you. When you make those first few sales, they're probably not profitable. Don't worry about that. That's not what you're after. You're going to spend more money and more time than you could ever possibly spend to scale that up. You're going to have a process that is not scalable. That's okay, because your goal with that first few sales is not to make a profit, it's to get market validation, and importantly, to get customer feedback and learn who the customer is and learn what they really need, what else they need that's a little bit different, or how they need your product fees for the longest time. And then once you learn, then you apply that skill. And this is really where you have the go-to-market strategy where you start thinking about all these different channels and opportunities to partner with people. So no matter whether you hire the salespeople or the salespeople work for a distributor or a reseller or an OEM, you have to get my share with these people. And most salespeople tend to be quite upgraded. So you need to have a clear alignment of incentives that you can communicate to those salespeople that if you present my product, you're going to get paid. And you're going to make more money by presenting my product than presenting some alternative. And that's a combination of having a real clear and compelling value proposition that's easily communicated, and training the sales staff on that, getting access to the sales staff on that, so that they believe it, and then combination of that plus incentives. So it's easy to sell, you're not going to knock yourself out, you're not going to waste your time trying to sell something and fail. And when you sell it, you're going to get paid. And it, again, it doesn't matter whether they work for you or not. If you're going for channel, they're not working. But you still need to have someone who's training them, keeping your stuff hot running, and still making sure that the incentives are lower. So you can't go to market without some marketing. So I have to just put in a little bit about marketing here. So how many of you are doing marketing now of some kind? Tell me what you do. Okay. And are you, so you put up a booth? You're going to
talk?
Okay. Well, I'll talk to you about it. Okay. All right. And what are you going to say? Okay. What are you looking for?
Did a bunch of stuff. I mean, we did booths at trade shows, we websites and press releases, that kind of stuff.
Yeah. Okay. Well, so the trick when you're in a startup, of course, is you don't have a lot of money. So you can't just, go buy TV ads, and that probably wouldn't make sense for what most of you are making anyway. So how do you do it on a low budget? Well, definitely crashing trade shows is a great way to go. Depending on where you're at in your cycle, you might take a booth, but also you can get a lot of value just going to the conference and walking and talking to people, and you may find the, asking to find the partners who are going to help you bring this into the market. Obviously, you have to have a website, and they're cheap. You can, put up a website. Make sure that you do a good job of it, and you can get much professional and communicate well. But it's not something that you have to spend for extra money on. Speaking is great. Did you mention you're speaking at the conference? No. I mean, it's not always easy to get a speaking spot, but if you are in that industry, you may know people who are the ones in the or know someone who is in with them. And if you can get a slot where you can speak, it just gives you more chance that you can present to and people come out and get a card and you can get other questions. And then social media, blogging, making videos, have a Facebook page. If you have a product that people are going to use, have a Facebook page and pay attention to it. If people are messaging you through it or posting on it, and keep their eyes on it. LinkedIn is a great tool for finding leads. So you can use something like LinkedIn Sales Navigator. And if you know that you need to find people at a certain kind of industrial company, you can drill down through LinkedIn and find all people at companies that fit your profile who have titles that are people you think you need to talk to. And then you can actually reach out through LinkedIn to try to connect with them, to get in touch with them. You also, there are tools out there like Organize that will enable you to take this list that you pulled up LinkedIn and drop it into their database, and they basically constantly running web callers that are scraping out emails and phone numbers to go with names. That's what we identified, and I've got this list of 80 people that I think I'm going to talk to. There are providers out there who can help you actually get their email address there. And of course, email marketing is pretty cheap. All of these things take work, all of these things take your time, but you may not have to spend that much money on when you have a very short budget. So, quick recap, basically, number one is you've got to know who your customer is. And you gotta keep your mind open and understand that may shift over time. Second, once you know who your customer is, that defines one of the ways to reach them and what are the messages that they're gonna respond to. You're probably getting your first few sales through direct interactions, people you know, or people that you find somewhere, and that's really good because once you learn what works, then you can figure out what's the right channel to scale up. Do I go through resale? Do I go to an OEM partner? And all the while as you're doing that, just you have to be aware of the market steps. So you have to have a financial model that lets you play with those variables and understand how much of that. I always start with the end user revenue. So because it's also useful to have kind of an figure of how much end user revenue you're driving. And you may often have a blended model where some of those sales are direct and you get a lot of revenue. But some of those sales are through partners and we'll get a portion of them. So, like I said at the beginning, I don't want to spend all the time lecturing. I'm actually wondering, do you folks have issues or concerns that
or are you wondering what direction to go?
Yeah, I have been publishing some books about English for Cambridge. So I just put the books on the Amazon website. But I really don't know how to get more attention, how to get to the students.
Right. And so you're trying to drive attention for some other books?
Yes.
Right. Yeah. Have you been able to try going the PR route? Have you tried using PR, getting people to write about your books, review them, talk about them, those kinds of things? Because to me, that's
supposed to be involved in having PR people.
Sometimes, yeah, but not necessarily a lot. Particularly, you actually can do it yourself to some degree. You know, if you're really going to be aggressive about it, then yes, you go hire a PR person, and that's someone who has relationships with editors and writers, and you know, gets you covered. But you can do it quite a bit yourself if you can just sort of think about who else would write about this or who would help promote this, and then you know, pitch to them that they should write a review or publish an article about your stuff.
Is there any risk? So as you're looking at these different kind of ways to access customers, is there any risk of going down a path that is going to eliminate other paths once you go down it? So I would imagine, for example, if you were to go to a distributor and set up a relationship, and maybe like it's working well, but then you have options to do direct. Then it seems like you'd be competing with your distributor, but you probably could make more revenue possibly with going direct. So I'm just curious what your thoughts are as to like at what point do you pursue those additional routes versus wait till you kind of have a better sense of maybe what the strategy should be? Or do you just kind of take a shotgun approach and see what sticks?
I think two things. One is that what you're describing is this often called channel clutter. So you may have multiple channels that are reaching the same customer, and people are you know, sort of fighting over who gets credit for that deal, or who gets to close that deal.
Yeah.
Sometimes that's good, it means you're succeeding. Sometimes it's a big problem, because you're going to end up with partners who are you know, booking deals for you, and they get pissed off because somebody swiped the deal. Particularly on the question of direct and indirect, if you have resellers, you need to be scrupulous about not undercutting them. And so you need to be really crystal clear that, yeah, people can come to our website and buy it, but they're not going to come to our website and buy it cheaper than you sell it. And that's usually their main concern. You may also find that you do different things in different territories, different geographies. So maybe that in your home territory, you sell direct, but then if you want to go sell it to Europe, you're going to have more access, you know, any connections or any view of that. And definitely in a situation where you know you've got an OEM partner who has one set of terms with you, bundles your stuff in, and they're out selling basically the same thing, maybe under a different label, different brand, and then you've got resale partners that are selling your stuff. I mean, an example of that, the first company I was with in the public was called Active Voice, and it's called Business Voice Messaging Systems. And we sold on our own brand, also sold on our own brands, and you know, we sold some direct, we sold some through resellers, and you know, we had stuff going all the time. And the key is you just have to manage it, and you have to manage it again, with you know, with ethics. If you start undercutting your distribution, yeah, we're off. What else?
Apparently, the resource or service where you can find out numbers of people within a certain demographics, like, you know, how many people between 30 and 40 own iPhones versus Android, that kind of thing.
There's all kinds of market research out there, and actually I think if you have a UW Net ID, I think you have access to UW Business Network. Is that correct? Is anybody? Yeah. So you can actually, there's a zillion reports that get published, and the provider's always going to charge it, so, you know, you want to spend $2,000 to $3,000 for that report, probably not. But you may be able to go to the UW Library, and they have, you know, a bunch of them they subscribe to, which you can actually dig out a lot of data.
So we have a diagnostic kit that's also mainly business, and it's a product and a service, but we're trying to do it
Okay.
And we haven't really run it so much, but we already have everything figured out, you know, manufacturing, supply, development, all that.
Okay.
And we're just getting ready to talk to them. So we're looking at talking with our research collaborators and also looking at industry. And we're kind of wondering about our strategy. Should we try to refine our pitch a little bit before we talk to bigger people that want to talk to us already? But is that, we don't want to lose a huge sale.
Right. Well, so you don't want to be, you don't want to have an analysis paralysis where you just, you know, you're trying to make it perfect before you go pitch. But you do want to be prepared. So I hope that really answers your question. I mean, the answer is yes, you need to have a pretty good idea of what it is they care about and how what you have is going to, you know, meet their, fix their pain, or give them some basic pain again. And so actually next week's session that Ken is doing is all about that, the value proposition, helping you think through this. There's actually a pretty structured process to help you think through and tighten up your value proposition, which can lead to a much better slide deck for those kinds of meetings.
So we're kind of looking at
Definitely, absolutely, yeah. Yeah, I mean, getting out there and talking to people is how you get that feedback to find out whether what I'm saying holds water. Right, so you have to get out there and talk to people. And it's just a question of making sure that, like you said, that big deal that you kind of got to iron out here pretty well here. What kind of businesses do you want to sell to?
So it would be basically feeling industry, so it would be
Yeah, and that would be for distribution. So the diagnostic kit is something, it's a better
yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it would be
And your business model is a combination of you sell them the kit and then you process the test. That's what's product and service for. And
we don't have to roll out
There also are agents, depending on what industry you're in. You know, there are people who are making their living as independent manufacturers of wraps. And so, again, depending where you are, so in some cases that's quite normal, and they're strictly their mission.
Are market people, the sales people, you're in the same function of people or do you sell them different?
When you're a startup and you only have two or three people, it's all of you. And particularly, you know, there's usually one person who comes in and do sales and marketing or offer it. But ultimately, you know, as soon as you start growing, they're really two different activities. So I think of it very simple. Marketing's job is to find qualified leads. The job is to make a phone ring. Sales job is to take those leads and close them. So chase these people down and, you know, keep at them, keep pitching them, and get them to sign up for the mailing list.
Is that, I think my question is, is there some people are particularly adept or at marketing, or some other people are more, you know, favorite?
Selling, absolutely. Definitely. There's people who are really good at building person-to-person relationships and face-to-face selling. And they're also, part of their skill set is, as I mentioned, work ethic. It's just, I mean, it's, you know, it's hard to do. It's hard to get up every day and start making phone calls and get rejected over and over and be excited to do it again the next day. And there's certain people that have that as part of their skill set and are, you know, excited about that. There are other people who are really good at telling a story in a compelling way, or at producing beautiful materials that get your audience's attention. Or the other aspect of marketing is really good at just studying the numbers and understanding what's happening with your sales, what's happening with your target audience, and how they definitely are two different. You know, even though there's often a B2B and sales marketing, marketing and sales are two different skill sets. Anything else? Yeah.
So we publish a lot of press releases and stuff, and so my question is, how can we get those in the hands of like reporters?
Yeah, that's a challenge. You know, there are news services that will just put it on the wire for you, but to get a reporter to pick it up, typically requires somebody to kind of put it under their nose and convince them that this is what they want to talk about. Unless you have, you know, some groundbreaking thing that, you know, is right down the alley for a reporter who's actively covering that. So ways to get in front of them, you can hire PR people who have those relationships and are able to get somebody to answer the phone, get an editor to answer the phone and pitch your story. Or you may never know, like, what do you read? Depending on what sector you're in, what industry you're in, like, where do you go over your books? Whose blogs do you read, or what magazines do you read? And you can find those editors and reach out directly and, you know, tell them about your sightings. But if you just put out a press release and pay somebody the $200 or whatever on PR as well, the odds of someone picking it up are pretty slim. But it still actually gives you something to put on your website, though, that makes, you know, makes your company more credible, because the people who come to your site, they go through all these releases, and be the customers, be the investors, they can see that there's progress happening. Others? Okay, all your problems are solved. That's great. Well, hopefully this was useful, and if you need to follow up with other questions that come to mind, my email is really simple. It's mike@gw. All right. Thanks.
So we'll start the next presentation at 1, if you guys want to grab some more in the office. Thank you.
It's like a corn one.
What is this?
What do you guys think?
The little ones are good, they're like amazing.
Is this something to order again, or was it too weird? No, I liked it. I didn't know what I got.
The corn one was weird.
Okay. Yeah, and then, no, that's the corn, that's the little thing.
That's the sweet one.
Yeah, I don't.
There's another one.
There was a sweet one. Yeah.
All the meaty ones are better.
Yeah.
I don't know. studying.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, it's chemistry and media engineering.
So communication, yeah, so I mean, I've worked with some of the students, you know, before, and then prior to that, I was working, I was more on the creative.
I was gonna get a coke there. I never drink pros, I always.
What's that? Yeah, like a therapy. So right now, he's back on his electric.
Both of them.
And a third is exercise.
A lot of.
Yeah. How many, have you been involved in other stuff? Do you enjoy it? Yeah.
Hey, everybody, thanks so much. It's great to be here. This is Carol White and Kelsey Christensen from the Entrepreneurial Law Fund, and we're going to talk about board governance and advisors. Do you want to say any words about the Entrepreneurial Law Fund?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, fantastic. I'm so glad. So, board advisors, identification, fiduciary duties, all that stuff is going to be great. Let's hear it.
Thank you. Well, first off, thank you all for coming today. We're really excited to talk with you about board governance and advisors. I'm Kelsey, and this is my colleague, Carolyn. As Kira mentioned, we are the Entrepreneurial Law Clinic at the School of Law just up the hill. The Entrepreneurial Law Clinic is an innovative clinic where second and third year students help entrepreneurs throughout the Pacific Northwest. So getting started. So just first right off the bat, we just want to little notice, we're not here to provide specific tailored legal advice for you. It's more of a general overview. So we do advise that you have specific questions and you can consult your own attorneys. And then pass it over to Carolyn to start. So kind of the where we wanted to start first of all is just like what is a board of directors, what is corporate governance, and then what is a board advisor. So I think the most important thing to start off with is that whatever, if you already have an entity or you're thinking about forming an entity, it's important to remember that it's a creature of state law. Either depending if you're incorporated, if you're in Washington or Delaware or some other state. And under most state corporate laws, all of the power of the corporation is invested in the board of directors. And so the board of directors is a group of individuals that are elected as, or elected to act as, representatives of the stockholders to establish corporate management and related policies and take decisions on major corporate issues. That's really formal. But basically what that means is that they're in charge of running the corporation. They oversee the officers and they all the way down to the employees. And the most important concept here is the concept of delegation. So as I mentioned, this corporate state laws invest power to run the corporation into the board of directors. And they, in turn, then delegate their authority to run the corporation to officers. And so whenever you hear about, you know, board authorization, that's kind of what they're referring to. In terms of corporate governance refers to the structures and processes by which corporations are directed and managed. Again, it's very formal, but it's kind of the processes that are in place to make sure that that delegation of authority is happening, that there's accountability in place, and that that there are committees being established to review different things, so you hear like audit committees or independent committees, compensation committees. These are all very public-oriented so probably not necessarily suited directly to your needs right now. And then what is a board advisor? A board advisor is not a board of director. It's an advisor that the board of directors can invite to participate in meetings. Usually they're individuals with business experience or other relevant expertise who advises the company, board of directors, and management. Generally, I think the most important thing here to note is that they do not participate in votes, they're not making any decisions, they're just solely there to advise. Just to take a step back, Kelsey forgot to mention that if you guys have any questions, just please jump in. We want this to be interactive. We'll also have a question time at the end as well.
Okay, I have a question here.
Yes.
So is a board advisor and actually invited by the board, or it can also be invited by the CEO or other officers?
So how does the board of advisors kind of be invited, or how do they get involved in the corporation?
Who can invite?
I think it just kind of depends, but in general, where you most commonly see a board advisor is maybe you have an investor that doesn't actually want a board seat, but they want to be involved in the kind of board meetings, because we have observer roles, and generally speaking, so sometimes it can come from the investor side. I think sometimes the board themselves can basically realize, oh, you know, we're encountering this type of problem, so maybe we should seek this type of advice. Like, maybe you want a banker, maybe you want an accountant. I don't know the specifics of, like, I think it really depends on the corporation, but, like, what the circumstances are as to why you would want to invite an advisor. But, My instinct is that the board would have to approve the advisor. So, yeah, I don't know if that answers your question.
Good question?
Yeah.
Where are the pages from?
It's just a mixture of kind of our classwork and just conversations with our advisors. So.
So you're not quoting any
state law?
Statute.
No. Okay, so getting down more into the nuts and bolts of a board of directors, the first thing you want to consider is the size of your board of directors. And these can range depending on the needs of the company, anywhere from as few as 3 directors to as more 15 directors. I don't know if there's any larger than 15, but I don't think it's not possible. And generally speaking, with size, you want to have an odd number. This is just to prevent the inevitable ties that there is someone who can break that tie. For term lengths, the default is that directors are normally elected either as voted by the shareholders or they resign. So a shareholder can then vote out board of directors if they want. And I think you said earlier, term length is normally about a year, right?
I think typically you vote on it yearly, but again, it could specify differently in your bylaws.
Yeah. And then for qualifications, you want to have a diverse group of directors to bring different roles to the board. So some key considerations are going to be industry background, financial and business expertise. If you're going public, if that's a plan for the company, you want to have maybe a board of director that had experience with bringing a company to the public sphere. And then also reputation. So you want people who are experienced in the type of company that you are running, as well as experience with any type of issue that may arise. And again, this goes to the advisors that Carolyn was speaking to. If a problem arises that the board of directors does not have expertise for, that's when you want to go and invite a board advisor on. You also want to have a staggered board. And generally what this means is that each director is elected for a 1-year term. That's where I pulled that from. And it stands, the director is going to stand for re-election each year at the annual stockholders meeting. And that is a statutory requirement that the board of directors does do hold a statutory, an annual stockholder meeting. Okay, moving next to the election of directors. Corporate laws of many states provide that unless otherwise specified in the company's organizational documents, so either the articles of incorporation or the bylaws, the director is elected by a plurality of the votes cast. And then for independent directors, you want to have a director on your board that is not connected or associated with the company in any matter, and that works only to safeguard the interest of the members and individual
cannot bring their interests before the board. So you want an absence of a material relationship for these independent directors, as well as an absence of any pecuniary relationship as well.
Okay, I have a question here. So does the independent director have a voting power? Is vote or vote count?
No, an independent director is going to be a full director. He's going to have just as much of a vote as an interested director. But generally speaking, why you want an independent director is because there's going to, we're going to touch upon this later in a different slide, there's this concept of the duty of loyalty. So if you have an interested transaction, let's say that Kelsey and I are brothers, sister and sister, and I'm on the board of directors, and Kelsey owns a company, and I want to engage her services, that's going to be an interested transaction. And therefore, sometimes the presence of an independent director is important on a board then, because it adds more, I don't know if the phrase, but it kind of blesses the transaction a little bit more, because an interested, a non-interested party is voting on whether or not this is a good deal or not, being engaged with Kelsey's company.
There's no presumption that Carolyn, the director, would be acting in her own self-interest rather than in the interest of the company.
Could you also, is that something that is really valuable for people who are at the early stages of company? Because I can totally see, as you get like larger, maybe you have a higher about like volumes of transactions, but for like really like small early stage companies who might have a board of 3 to 5, how important is that like independent direction and expectation that people are going to look to see, or is that, I don't know, maybe your thoughts?
I would say that your typical startup is probably not going to have a true independent director at the beginning. It's going to be something more that you're going to see as you grow in size. I think typically, and my supervisor can jump in if I say something incorrect, typically in a startup situation, you're probably going to have maybe an angel investor, a co-founder, and maybe another person. That's a common fault. And not going to have a true independent person. The independent director comes in more as you grow in size, and there's potential for more kind of big decisions that you want an independent person on the board helping you make decisions.
That's correct. Yeah. Carolyn's exactly right. There's no requirement to have any independent directors unless you're a public company. That's an independent firm. So private company doesn't have to have any, regardless of its size or its stage. And most early stage companies are not going to have independent directors. But once a company receives financing, usually the source of that financing gets representation on the board, and that would technically be an independent director because they're not involved in the day-to-day management of the company. Yeah. So that's probably the first time it comes up. And then the further you go, the board composition is driven by the needs of the company and who can help the company. So eventually you start getting some independent directors. So certainly on this effort.
So this is kind of a nice segue into our, this leads us to our next segue to our next conversation, which is fiduciary duties. And so as a board of director, as a director, you have fiduciary obligations to the corporation. You are in a position of authority, and you are supposed to look out for the best interests of the corporation. And essentially, the two main fiduciary duties are the duty of care and the duty of loyalty. The duty of care means that you need to basically use reasonable due diligence. You have to act with, like, I don't know how to phrase this properly, but actually, you know what? He's going to phrase it properly? Kelsey's going to phrase it properly.
So before we go into that, I will say that these duties are regulated by statutory law for the state of incorporation, wherever the company is incorporated. They also come from common law rules, which would be through the case law. So the courts, they take the statutes, and then they interpret these statutes based on the issues before the court, and so that becomes case law and binding on the duties. Also, these duties can come from the corporation operating agreements themselves, so the articles of incorporation or the bylaws, and then also your stockholders, depending on how active they are in the climate of the organization, can push the directors to make sure that they're following these fiduciary obligations. So the duty of care, reports will look to the process of the decision-making of the director rather than the substance of the decision itself. So really, like I say on the slide here, it's not, these standards may be semantic and they're going to differ from state to state. But really what it means is that when making decisions, a director needs to be informed. A director can't just rubber stamp something without really looking into, you know, why this decision needs to be made and whether or not it's in the best interest of the company. And they also have to know the material facts for this decision, again, that are reasonably available. So it really is, when the courts are looking at it, whether or not an ordinary person within that direct, in the same situation as the director, would have made the same decision. And again, they must exercise all of their corporate responsibilities in good faith. So again, what this basically just means is the best interest of the company. If a director acts with bad faith, for example, intentional failure to act on behalf of the company, or violation of a known duty, again, duty of care, or a conscious disregard of their responsibilities as a board director, a known violation of the law, or if they act with a purpose other than the best interest of the company. Going back to the example that Carolyn gave, if we were sisters and I was a board of director and she owned her own company and was willing to sell to my company, and instead of bringing that decision before the board or telling the board it wasn't a good decision, I purchased it on my own, that would be a violation of my responsibility, the duty of care, because I'm taking advantage, and the duty of care too, which we'll get into in a second, because I'm taking advantage of an opportunity for the company for my own benefit.
So on a practical level, kind of what, to satisfy your duty of care, generally speaking, is that if you're gonna make a decision, you wanna see the paperwork to back it up. You know, you wanna make sure that you are seeing reports, and you wanna make sure that you understand the kind of the ins and outs of why this decision is necessary and why you guys are making it.
Yeah, and another thing that benefits directors is that courts really don't want to second guess the decisions of directors, because courts recognize that the directors and business individuals are going to be more in tune to what the business needs. So what this is called is the business judgment rule, and this is just a presumption that the directors are complying with the duty of care. But again, if there is bad faith, that presumption is gone. If you act in bad faith, the court will not protect a director with a business judgment rule.
Just to jump in here too, an important part of kind of evidencing that you're following the duty of care is generally, it relates back to the concept of corporate governance. Kind of the main documents that come out of the board of directors are going to be the board of minutes, and then also any written consent. And I don't know if you've ever heard of these terms before, but they're very formal legal terms, and essentially they're just ways to evidence that a board has made a decision. And within the board of minutes, generally it's a pretty formal kind of template that follows. It kind of establishes, okay, we held a meeting at this place at this time, these are all the individuals that are in attendance. And it kind of follows through that, like, board discussed, let's say that you were deciding to engage with a bank, and that you're going to open up a bank account. And the board of directors would be like, let's say Kelsey's on the board. Board member Kelsey raised the issue of getting a bank account discussed. Like, you know, they discussed the pros and cons of getting a bank account with Bank of America, for example, versus Wells Fargo. You know, it's kind of like bare bones, but you're describing, like, a discussion took place, you know, it was raised by one board member, and that, and then you go to this, we call them resolution. Then resolved, you know, resolved that we will establish a bank account with Bank of America on X date, you know. So kind of what you're doing there in terms of the duty of care is that you're saying, okay, we considered this, we considered that, and then we decided to do this based off of the conversations that we had. So you're showing that you took reasonable care, you thought about it, you were, you know, you weren't just making this decision by the seat of your pants.
Yeah, so a good way to think about the duty of care is just that you're acting on an informed basis. And just to conclude the duty of care, this last point on the slide, one of the ways you can do that is to engage expert opinions. So if you don't know, if a problem arises and as a director you don't know how to fix that problem or resolve that problem, it's a good thing to do to hire an expert. Hired expert is not going to immediately, you know, it's not going to say that if you do something wrong, it's not just business judgment here. The business judgment rule will protect you, but hiring experts is not necessarily enough. You have to show that you've really taken the time to understand all of the material facts and that you are acting as an informed director.
Yeah, I have a question here. Who is recording the meetings? Is the meeting audio feed?
So generally you have a secretary of the meeting.
Yeah.
And that secretary can be another board member, it can be an official position, it can be your attorney if you have an attorney. It's generally just officially called the secretary. And then just a good kind of good housekeeping thing to keep in mind is that you kind of want to, I mean, at startups it's hard, I imagine, but just a good thing to have in your back of mind is like a document retention policy, because you want to make sure that there's only one official record of what was occurring at your board meeting. And generally that official record is your board minutes. And so, you know, obviously directors may come in and they may jot down notes and like, you know, to refresh your memory, you know, the future board members, but you generally want one official record, and that record is produced by the secretary, and at the next board meeting, kind of the first call of business is to approve last board minutes meetings.
The experts can be of all kinds, right? Could be legal, evaluation, attorney, another attorney, evaluation expert.
Yes,
like an investment banker would evaluate.
Yes, absolutely. And generally speaking, in terms of like, let's say that you were considering having an investor come in, and you engage with a broker or an investment banker, kind of the stuff that you would want to see in terms of satisfying your due care is that, you know, you have seen the valuation model, you have pulled the outputs of the model at least, you probably not going to go into the details of like, okay, what assumptions did you use? But generally speaking, kind of in that board minutes to evidence, you know, that you met your due care is that you reviewed the document prepared by the investment banker, you considered it, you asked questions, but yes.
So I know this is part of the Washington State for the public and some private as opposed to duty care. Is that just across the board?
It's across the board. It's for profits, nonprofits. Generally speaking, this goes to an important point. The larger your corporation is and public it is, this is all going to be pretty standard. You're going to have a set thing in place in terms of good corporate governance. There's a higher risk as a startup that you're not following corporate formalities, but like again, that's it's highly recommended that you get in the habit early on of like having coordinates, having written consents, just to make sure that everything is in good order, that if you do have investors come. It's the way why it may not be perfect what you're doing, but at least you're evidencing like good board decisions are being made.
Maybe another thing too, just in terms of like state differences, Delaware has its own Court of Chancery that specifically only deals with businesses. Issues of businesses, and so their case law is going to be way more developed on, you know, duty of care, duty of loyalty. Whereas in Washington, there's not going to be that full spectrum of case law. So you always want to look first to the statutory requirements. But I think within Delaware, it's going to be way more developed on what that duty actually entails.
So you have a Delaware company that's doing business in Washington, the board sits in Washington.
It's going to be under the law of the state of incorporation. It's where the company is incorporated.
So is it possible that the venue is going to be King County Superior and then going to be Superior Delaware law?
I think it depends on, like, if you're incorporated, it's called the internal, I can't remember what it's called right now. But it's basically the concept is whatever state you're incorporated in, that's your governing law. However, you may be incorporated in Delaware, but and again, I don't imagine this scenario coming up, but you could be incorporated in Delaware, but be sued by a Washington State individual, and they're gonna maybe sue you in Washington State Court, but then the internal affairs doctrine holds that the Washington State Court would have to look to Delaware law.
Yep, so I can jump in there. That's exactly right. And it's possible you could end up litigating a Delaware law issue in a Washington court in a fact pattern like that.
It's also possible that if it's a purely corporate law issue, the Washington court would say we don't have sufficient expertise to weigh this issue. And the dispute between the parties here is solely a matter of Delaware law, and so the venue for that is going to be the Delaware courts. So if it's purely a corporate issue, it's more likely that the case will end up in Delaware, even if it's originally brought in Washington. But to the extent that there is, you know, proper jurisdiction for the claim in Washington, that it could easily happen that the Washington court applies to Delaware law. It's a good point on Washington versus Delaware, though, because that's an early question for a startup company. And as they said, the law in Delaware is a lot more developed, which can actually be a reason to gravitate towards Delaware. It's an inquiry into these sorts of corporate governance issues in Washington is going to be less reliable because there isn't as much precedent here. So you would end up then under a situation where the court doesn't have as much expertise and the case law isn't there, and the reliability of the outcome in a dispute scenario would be lesser even than it would be in the law.
So moving next to the second fiduciary duty, the duty of loyalty, we've kind of touched on this a little bit already, but the duty of loyalty requires the directors and officers to exercise their responsibilities and their powers as a director with the primary interest of the corporation rather than out of self-interest. And again, don't take over corporate opportunities for their own benefit at the expense of the corporation. So there's two main components here for the duty of loyalty, and that is whether or not a director is interested and whether or not a director is independent. So an interested director is one that is a party to the transaction. This would mean that the director has either a business, financial, or a family relationship with the party of the transaction. Again, going back to that scenario hypothetical that Carolyn and I were talking about, where we were sisters and we were both on other ends, each end of the transaction. And so this basically means that the director's judgment is clouded with respect to this transaction, and there's really no way to separate out whether or not that director is acting within their own self-interest or with the primary interest of the corporation. And it's more likely than not that this could result in an adverse consequence for the company. And this is also when the director is subject to a controlling interest by the party or the transaction. And the other component is the independence. So this is whether or not a decision is based on the corporate merits of the subject before the board rather than extraneous considerations or influences. And these extraneous considerations or influences may exist when the director is controlled by another. So if there's one board director who, let's say, is really controlling all the board, he's really powerful, and the other directors maybe don't want to step on his toes or they don't want to get in a fight with him, you know, there's ways to show whether or not that board director is really influencing the decision of the other directors. This could also be, too, if... you know, maybe those two board directors have transactions outside of their responsibilities of the director. So, you know, maybe one director owes the other, you know, some money. That director is not independent of the other because he doesn't want to ruin that side relationship. And again, these factors can include whether or not they're family members, whether or not they have personal relationships, or whether or not they have business relationships as well. And so really this comes down to like a conflict of interest. And if there is a conflict of interest that a court finds, that director is no longer going to be subject to the protection of the business judgment rule. And yeah, again, so that presumption really just goes away.
And then I just think the most important thing to remember is that, again, as a director, you're a fiduciary. And so you have a duty to the entity. That means that you just need to disclose all conflicts. Yeah.
And again, a huge thing here too is just acting in good faith. You know, because if the board or the court finds that there's bad faith on the part of any of the directors, it's more likely that there's going to be an adverse consequence coming out of that. So indemnification. So generally, kind of how we've been talking about the duty of care and duty of loyalty and how you can breach them. So a lot of state laws are permit that a company can indemnify its directors for breaches of the duty of care, for example. Essentially what that means is that they'll indemnify them for expenses incurred related to, like, if the director and or the company both get sued, they'll cover the expenses, assuming that they're not in bad faith. And this, like, the defense against claims where the director acted in good faith and not against the company's best interest, so that would affect the duty of loyalty. So if you breach the duty of loyalty, like, you likely won't be indemnified. Indemnification for breaches of duty of and then often, so these are provided by state law. They permit me to do it, but to actually do it, you generally need to have it in your organizational documents. And by organizational documents, we mean your charter, your certificate of incorporation, your articles of incorporation. And then you can also supplement them by having a separate indemnification agreement. I don't know if you guys have come across this really excellent resource, the NBCA website. So it's the National Council of But anyway, so they have a model indemnification agreement that is up there. I highly recommend looking at it. I think it kind of provides a really nice, distinct overview of what an indemnification agreement looks like.
Would the corporation get, because they need to get the hook for expenses, have officers and directors insurance, or?
That's our next slide. Was there a second part to that question?
Well, I'm just curious, who pays for it? Is it the director or the company?
In my experience, I think that would be the company pays that expense, and that, generally speaking, a director. I would be shocked if most directors would agree to move forward without having an indemnification agreement in place and directors and officers insurance. There's some specifics that Kelsey will go over about the scope of coverage, but kind of big picture, there's some are prepaid and some are reimbursement. I think prepaid is more common. So they'll prepay, and then if you find out that you actually did violate a duty, you did violate a duty of loyalty, you'll personally know.
Yeah, and then just following up with reimbursement, some insurance plans require that the director or the company pay the defense costs and the losses out of pocket. And if you are found not to be liable for any of the charges against you, the insurance will reimburse those costs. But kind of just taking a step back and let's chat about what a director or not's liability insurance actually is. So this insurance, as Carolyn said, you know, every director is probably going to want director and officer liability insurance. And they can seek either full or partial protections arising from violations of either civil obligations, fiduciary duties, as we already discussed, or other responsibilities, and they can seek their defense costs in the form of this insurance. So just in terms of the scope of coverage, it covers defense costs, so the lawyer fees for defending against the case, financial losses, and as well as any payment of claims. Normally under these plans, the director and or officer is required to retain their own counsel. So you can't have counsel for the company, like an in-house counsel, defend the director or officer. They need to go to a separate law firm. And then as we've discussed, there's prepaid versus reimbursement plans. Typical exclusions include dishonesty, which can include fraud, any criminal indictments, or intentional non-compliance with any of your duties or your responsibilities. Another one is personal profit, so this goes more to the duty of loyalty. If you're taking advantage of a personal opportunity, instead of acting in the best interest of the company, that will typically not be covered by director and office liability insurance. And then pollution and any bodily injury or property damage is more typical. And these policy premiums can range anywhere from $500 per year per million dollars of coverage to $10,000 per year for a higher risk director. And there's three different types of coverage.
So what these are called are Side A coverage, which covers individual directors and officers. Side B coverage, which covers the company if they choose to support their directors or officers. And then Side C coverage, which covers the company in their own right in the event that they're being sued for something that isn't covered by a commercial liability insurance that the company itself would have.
So I think the best way to think about it is this way. The duty of your fiduciary duties, your duty of care and duty of loyalty set up the required behavior of a director. Indemnification provides a way to protect against that if you breach that. And then directors and insurance liability is a way to pay for it at the end of the day. So it's kind of like links in a chain.
I'm actually going to run off, so apologies if you guys hear me from this later, but at what point do you suggest startups actually have a board? Like the second you incorporate?
Yes.
Okay.
So this goes back to my original point is that if you incorporate under state law, like an incorporation is a creature of state law, and that state law requires that all power is invested in the board of directors.
So initially that's usually just your CEO or CEOs who are on the articles of incorporation and your operating agreement.
So generally actually there's even a spot in your articles and I would recommend against putting actual names of the directors, but you can actually even list out directors in your articles of incorporation if you wanted to. But kind of like the first step of a corporation is you file your paperwork and then you establish the board of directors and the board of directors kind of ratifies everything. All the steps that have been taken by the incorporator. So, number one.
Yeah.
So, if you're not on the board of directors, like, how does it apply to people that are
you mean like an officer?
Yeah. I'm the board of directors. Is this all for exactly the board of directors?
No, okay, so think of it like, so you have the corporation, and then you have the board of directors, and the board of directors then in turn delegates the authority down to officers, and the officers oversee the senior management, and so on and so forth, so on and so forth. And then kind of like the employee level, they are, like they're accountable obviously to the directors are accountable to senior management, and so on and so forth. So it's kind of like a hierarchy down and forth. And so, that answer your question?
Yeah, so. Are you more wanting to know whether or not the fiduciary duties flow down?
Yeah,
okay.
On that one, so, you know, if you're, say you're like one of the low director level, what responsibilities do you have, and what do you need to say, like, how do you manage it?
It's going to be typically more governed by your employee handbook, but I don't really think that a fiduciary duty is applied to a employee, but generally speaking, like, yeah, it's your handbook, employee handbook. In terms of, like, officers themselves, if an officer sits on the board of directors, you obviously would have a fiduciary duty.
I believe the CEO in most companies typically sit on the board of directors, but I don't think it's a
required. It depends, yeah.
But if an officer doesn't sit on the board of directors, he also can have liability insurance.
He can too, yeah.
I have a question, and this maybe just arises from some confusion. So, if you have a board, like a director who does something wrong, how does indemnification fit into that?
So, basically, indemnification fits because let's say that I approved a transaction and I didn't even read the packet, and it was a really bad transaction.
Yeah.
Indemnification fits then in terms of that. If I get sued as a director, in my capacity as a director,
who's going to sue you?
A shareholder would sue you. It's called a derivative suit.
So what if you don't have share, who's the shareholder? Like anyone who holds shares, like if you gave equity to an employee?
Exactly.
They could sue a director and say like you made a bad decision.
And that's called, yeah, and generally speaking, that's called a derivative suit.
Okay.
And it's a really weird legal fiction where basically is that the shareholder is suing the director on behalf of the corporation itself. So it's a weird legal, it's a weird dynamic. And essentially, indemnification fits in because they will step up and say, so long as you didn't act in bad faith, director, we're going to cover you. It's a But that being said, that's only to an extent, and that's how the record of liability insurance comes in, is that it basically goes to bill.
Yeah. Well, it pays to the suit, like if you have a shareholder. So I'm just thinking like really practically. From a like, small corporation, you have a handful of employees, their shareholders, and they file a suit. Are they using in-house counsel?
No.
They're using their own counsel to file a suit against the company.
And they pay their own expenses.
Yes.
Gotcha.
Exactly. There's actually, for big public companies, there's like an entire cottage industry built around derivative suits. But yeah, typically, the in-house counsel only represents the corporation. And in a situation like this, if there really is a derivative suit, in-house counsel would not be, like, they would be involved in like a kind of managing role, but you would get outside counsel. I think this brings it like just kind of a nice point to point out is ultimately is that, you know, the directives, if you engage counsel, it represents the corporation. It doesn't represent necessarily the directors individually. It represents them in terms of like their capacity as a director for the corporation. But if something like this happened, you as a director will totally want your own independent counsel in front.
So we wanted to talk briefly, obviously we're here in Washington, but as we've mentioned, Delaware has a specific power of chancery and that can lead to companies wanting to incorporate in that state. So in terms of the different requirements of each state law, Washington requires that board of directors hold an annual meeting. And within this requirement, the board of directors has to identify a meeting time and location to each one of the directors. They also have to notice all of the shareholders. And then they also have to provide a record date of when that meeting is going to take place. And this is all within the statute in Washington. Delaware, on the other hand, similarly, they call it something different. Washington gets into more specifics about meeting time and location and the notice of shareholders. Delaware is called it written notice. So that's going to be to all of your directors and all of your shareholders as well. And then again, meeting time and location, but Delaware specifies that this needs to be not less than 10 days or more than 60 days before the meeting is to take place. In terms of the duty of care, as we mentioned, Delaware has the courts that have a way more developed case law. So looking to the statute for Washington defines the duty of care in three parts. So first, to perform in good faith. Second, to perform in a manner that is reasonably, that the director reasonably believes to be in the best interest of the corporation. And then to perform with care that an ordinarily prudent person would exercise under similar circumstances. And they also signify that the directors need to seek all material information. Delaware, on the other hand, states that the standard when making decisions is that they have to act on behalf of the best interest of the corporation. And then Delaware really just goes into the case law after that. So they specify within the statute that you have this duty. And then the courts jump in and they describe the duty of care as an obligation to use the amount of care which an ordinarily careful and prudent person would use in similar circumstances. And then the courts apply four different standards. So you have the business judgment rule, which we spoke about. They look at the analysis of the decision rather than the substance of the decision itself. So the board could make a bad decision, but as long as you took the necessary and proper steps to reach that decision, they're not gonna jump in and say, you know, what you did was wrong.
Incredibly deferential.
Absolutely, yeah. The Delaware courts also apply a statute of limitation on liability. And then there's the gross negligence standard. So if you're just completely negligent, you have a conscious disregard for your duty, that standard comes in and the business judgment rule is thrown out. And then in terms of the duty of loyalty, it's very similar where they set out within the statute what the standards are for Washington. So that a director is entitled to rely on information of opinions, reports, and statements if prepared or presented by either experts or officers to which the director reasonably believes to be reliable. Whether or not a committee of the board of directors of which the director is not a member, if the director reasonably believes that the committee merits confidence. And then again with Delaware, where they go more to the court opinions. So the duty of loyalty in Delaware requires that a director act in good faith, and that the decisions or transactions in which a majority of the directors have a conflict of interest or which an involving and controlling state stockholder on the other side of the transaction are not protected by the business judgment rule. So it really just goes into the case law. And then as a general matter, in Delaware, the burden of persuasion is shifted to the directors to demonstrate that there was an entire fairness in the decision-making process.
Yeah. Is there a difference in the company law with regards to what kind of corporation, for example, limited liability versus non-profit?
So, so generally speaking, the majority of what our advice that we've just been kind of going over has been focused solely on corporations. But at the end of the day, a for-profit corporation and a non-profit corporation, they're both corporations. Unless there's specific carve-outs in the non-profit statute itself, it's going to, all the same laws are going to apply. You're going to have to follow the same formalities. Your duty, your directors are going to be have the same duty of obligations. They should follow the same corporate governance, you know, have minutes, do written consent. So it's the same kind of thought process that you would want to see in a for-profit and non-profit.
What is unique about the profit?
Unique?
Yeah.
Generally, so a couple of things, for example, is a non-profit, you tend to see conflict of interest policies. You don't see them as much for for-profit corporations. Your, in respect to board governance, I can't really think of anything on the top of my head. In terms of your incorporating documents, there are specific things that you see in a nonprofit articles of incorporation, so like specific requirements for dissolution, specific prohibitions, but kind of the way that the corporation runs can be pretty similar in terms of the board governance structures in place.
But it might be the dissolution of the profit. The money
has to go.
Money has to go to the non-profit, right? And there's rules about how in a non-profit, how personally individuals can use funds, right? There's rules about that.
Oh, so for example, a non-profit corporation can't issue shares.
Right.
So you can't fundraise via equity.
Final question. Any other states other than Delaware that someone would consider incorporating?
I think it would just really depend on where you plan to do the majority of your business. So whenever you
a real case and founders where money will have a lot of money.
So I think it really just depends on what you envision your company doing. Ultimately, at the end of the day, there's a lot of different factors to consider. Where you're, for example, where your investors are sitting, where your management is sitting, where your target audience. Are you just doing this with Northwest products? Do you want to go globally? Do you envision going public one day? Do you not envision going public one day? There's a lot of different factors that go into it.
There's also costs associated as well. So you're going to have your costs associated with whatever you get incorporated, your annual fees. And then wherever you plan to do business, you're also going to need a business license within that state. And taxes and everything are going to come out of each one of those states as well. So it really just depends on how much time and money that you want to put into having a business in multiple states. Yeah.
Where is the director relationship formalized? Just in the minute book or?
Yeah, generally speaking, unless you have a specific director named in your articles of incorporation, what you would do would be you'd form the board of directors and then they would ratify the acts of the incorporator and then establish that these are our initial board directors.
So can you ever be sort of a deemed director without being listed in the minute books?
I think you
have any of these kinds of any of these kinds of warnings or caveats apply to you?
Here's
why I ask. Yeah. So for startups, typically my experience, the first experience they have with governance with a small g is with just a board of advisors, typically technical advisors, not directors. And I just sometimes those people act in ways that are sort of similar to actual directors. And I wonder if there's any risk there. Like I've been asked to act as an advisor before. And so I'm just wondering if is there any risk if you're not formally a director, if there's not a formal director relationship, is there any to be deemed to have needed to act with certain fiduciary responsibilities at the same time?
I mean, just kind of gut reaction. I can't really imagine the scenario that would happen because, again, it's all about document retention. Like, it's all about like, kind of what's in the. Think of your corporate minutes and your written consensus of the history of the corporation. And if, like, nowhere in those documents does it say Mr. X is a director now approved by the rest of the board, you're going to be.
So you can't be like a common law director?
No. That's not a concept that I've ever come across.
That's good.
But as an advisor, like even as a board advisor, keeping in mind these fiduciary duties is a very important thing because ultimately you're not doing you're not a good advisor.
But most of what you talked about applies to publicly traded companies or at least more sophisticated private companies that, as you pointed out, have investors that want to say in the matter.
Yeah.
And the very first, like I said, the very first experience anybody has with a board is even not a board of directors, it's more just a board of advisors.
But I think it is important to know that if you are a startup and you have taken the steps to incorporate, like now is the time to start getting your corporate books in order, because if one day you do want investors to come in, the first things they're going to ask to see are like, okay, I want to see your charter, I want to see your bylaws, I want to see any written consensus before the director has undertaken. And a lot of times you have to go back and do corporate cleanup. So if you're kind of in the habit already of knowing that this exists, like the better you are.
So how do you talk about like that directors can have conflicts of interest? Mm-hmm. So is that something that when directors have conflicts of interest, do they get to excuse themselves from a like vote or decision, or do they typically just disclose their conflicts of interest and then continue to vote? That just seems like ethically messy. Mm-hmm. And so I'm just wondering how that typically gets handled.
Definitely disclose, because then you can show the judge if there is a suit that comes before the court, they can say, like, yes, there was a conflict of interest, however, I disclosed it to the rest of the board, and then they were able to vote, we were all able to vote on the board with all material information.
So this is not going to be terribly helpful to start with, but generally speaking, the bigger the board are, the more selfish your company is, you kind of have this concept of that this interest minority vote approved it. So, but generally with a startup, there's three directors. If one director recuses himself,
What if in circumstances you had like two directors who said like, you know, if you have a clear conflict of interest, like maybe you can't, you're like don't have a lot of money, and you're trying to figure out who to pay, and you have a personal relationship between two directors, and then a director who's fighting for their salary,
mm-hmm.
for instance. In that case, you have a third. Maybe independent director in that case. I'm just curious, like, is that something where you need to, like, you can get yourself into trouble even with disclosing that, like, oh, we have a, you know, friendship that exists or something like that? And is that something you need to disclose every single board meeting or every time there's a decision that comes up, or is it, can you disclose it once to the board and then have it kind of exist? I'm trying to think of scenarios based on I have a board member who I'm good friends with, or we could get she's my PhD advisor, and so like I've known her for years, we have a friendship, and she's on my board of directors, and there's three of us. And so like how do I deal with not asking for specific advice, but in that kind of case, is there a reason to disclose that relationship multiple times to the board? When it's
it's a three-person board.
Yeah.
You know, I think one official disclosure. If a big decision's coming up, you definitely remind the board. In terms of recusing yourself from a vote, I'm gonna have to defer to Chris on this one because I actually don't know. Like, would you typically recuse yourself on a three-person board for a conflicted?
So it all.
reason we're talking about this is thinking about a situation in which there could be a shareholder claim that a transaction is not approved appropriately, or a director otherwise breached their duty of loyalty to the company. There are ways to mitigate the risk of such a claim, the most common of which is approval by a disinterested party. There's two flavors of that. The disinterested directors can approve that matter, and if there are none, which sometimes there would be no disinterested party, you can also get a shareholder vote, and if the majority of your disinterested shareholders approve the transaction, then you are significantly mitigating any risk associated with it. When you're going through the step of the independent approval of an action, you don't necessarily have to recuse. The director who's interested doesn't have to formally recuse themselves from the vote. They can if they want, or they can vote along. At the end of the day, it doesn't really matter, because the important piece is going to be what the disinterested people do. And as long as the conflict is fully disclosed, how that vote comes out among the disinterested people is not impacted by whether you participate. You want to look a little cleaner and say, I didn't even participate in the vote. Maybe a court, if it ever comes up, maybe a court puts some value on that, but it's not something that I would expect to be focused on.
And you said that, like, if for some reason it were to, like, split down the, like, interested, disinterested line, and in favor of the interested party, you could do a larger shareholder vote to kind of clear up the mess of that, or?
It would help. It would be problematic if you had disinterested directors disapproving a transaction.
Yeah.
Went ahead with it anyway because the majority of the board, including the conflicted people, approved it.
Yeah.
Then you're relying on your independent shareholders.
And at some point,
could be a mess.
Yeah, that's okay. Fair.
So I just want to direct all of your attention to this slide. This is the entrepreneurial law clinic that Carolyn and I are participating in this year at the UW School of Law. All of the information is on here. We do have a website where you guys can, if you want legal advice, you can fill out an application. And our director, Professor Jennifer Pan, goes over applications, and then each quarter the students are given clients to work with for that quarter, where we provide audit memorandums for the legal issues that may arise for your company or entity. So all of the information is here. And, well, any more questions? Last
question. The lawyers always say it depends, right?
we have three favorite phrases: reasonable, it depends, and. Let me get back to you.
I did actually chat recently.